I'm Rick Leonardi, penciler and of comic books for 32 years probably by now. Yeah, he was going to be either this from about 6th or 7th grade on. It was either going to be this or film animation. So one day in January of 1980, let's call it. I went to New York, came to New York on the train. I'd already sent some stuff down to both to DC and to Marvel for them to look at. And I also had an interview with an animation shop that had been set up by a teacher of mine on the same day. And the animation shop said, sure, we'll start you as an in-betweener at $250 a week, but you gotta live in New York City. So I did the math there, and that wasn't favorable. And then I talked to Shooter, and he said, yeah, we'll start you at $50 a page, and you can do 5 pages a week, but you can live in New Jersey, at least for the first 6 months of your apprenticeship. Then you can blow dodge. And I thought, well, you know, on balance, that's probably a better deal. So first 6 months of my career, first 6 months of 1980, I spent in a rented room in Montclair, New Jersey. Came across on the PATH train maybe 3 times a week, you know, for actual panel by panel tutelage. And then when that book was in the drawer, I was good to go. By the time this was Thor 303, by the time Thor 303 was on sale, it was that summer, and I had gone back to Boston. So I went to Newbery Comics, which at the time was a legend. So Amy Mann of Till Tuesday used to work there. I took the train down from where I lived there to just to haunt the place to see whether the book was out. One day it was. So it was a big day. I think I went through a phase where I'd start with the original, you know, the 11 by 17 board and try and hammer it out full size. But the limitations of that really become quickly apparent. I've heard that there are pencilers who can start at the upper left-hand corner of a board and just do it out, error-free, Mozart-like. But I'm not one of those guys. I make a lot of mistakes. I make a lot of decisions that I revoke. I do a tremendous amount of erasing. So just from the point of view of tearing up the paper, it wasn't going to work for me to go direct to the 11 by 17 sheet. So a couple ways you can cheat is, of course, you can use blue pencil. You can do your planning with blue pencil, and then once you're satisfied with what the blue pencil is showing you, go back with regular pencil, tighten it up from there. But that results, frankly, in a final product that just looks messy to me. It just wasn't a very satisfying, you know, final drawing to be turning in and getting paid for. So you're left with doing thumbnails. Now this is a typical thumbnail, and I've been working this way since about 1984, maybe 1982, and usually about this size, actually. And the step from here is some mechanical blow up. There you can use the old style artograph machine, which was an overhead projector kind of deal. Very expensive machine, very, very hot to use. You needed your own little table, really. The way we do things nowadays is to take this down to our local Kinko's, throw that down on a copier, blow it up to 225%, and bring it back to the light table. And that seems to be working pretty well. I've worked that way now for probably 15 years. The project I'm working on right now, as we speak, is it's this, actually. It's called Watson and Holmes. It's a redo, revisit of the Sherlock Holmes story. It's put out by New Paradigm Press. It's Watson Holmes transposed to America, transposed to Harlem. Watson Holmes, couple of black guys, which is very interesting from the point of view of challenging stereotypes. And, well, introduces a lot of fun themes. But what's cool, or groundbreaking, or different, at least from my experience, is we're scanning our pencils. Here's page 10, Watson approaching Baker Street for the first time. But those are pencils. Scanned at 600 DPI, again, at the local Kinko's. So I don't know, is this the wave of the future? You can see where I've gone and grabbed things off the internet and just dropped them in. Little effects are possible that I wouldn't have tried before. Text tool in Photoshop for business cards.
There's nothing better than knowing that your movie is something that you create.
But yeah, I mean, this is where we're at now, I guess. There's a promo piece. More promo pieces. I guess one key benefit, of course, is you know, exactly what you pencil is what's going to appear. There really isn't, there's not going to be any flaws in translation, and where that really shows up to your benefit is in close work. Construction of the faces, construction of eyes, things like that. The sorts of really fine, almost, you know, the kind of work that you almost need a magnifier for, those are the kinds of things that inkers, you know, and sort of endemically have trouble with. Those where the inker kind of can basically damage a drawing. It's no fault of his own, it's just that, you know, it's too small, it's too tight, and you've probably hacked the paper to ribbons anyway with a pencil. So, but now you can get exactly the effect you want. Now, you have to balance that against the loss of that discrete point of view. You know, the fact that in the old days, comic books were a fusion of the penciler's point of view, his unique perspective, and the inker, who is, you know, an equivalent artist with an equivalent point of view, only in a different medium. Now you don't have that kind of fusion effect. You don't have that kind of, you know, collaboration. You know, the best drawings, the best books from my career tend to be the ones where the inker has allowed himself some free range and has done some things that, you know, with or without my permission, and created some effects that I didn't count on. And those are the ones, those are the books that I go back to, and they're the most fun to look at. And that's all gone now, you know? So, long story short, I'm not sure it's a good thing. So, the penciler is the advocate for the reader. The penciler's the guy who's looking out for the interests of the poor, poor reader. And that's because the writer,
thank you so much,
you know, the writer has this blinding inspiration. He's got the overview, he's got the outline, he's got, it's his sandbox, his rules, and he skips things because he's so enthusiastic and he already knows what's going to happen, and he's really in a hurry to drag you along, you know, to show you what's, you know, let's go. I got stuff to show you. Let's go. But the reader doesn't have all those advantages. He doesn't have the outline. He doesn't have, you know, he doesn't have the writer's hindsight or foresight. He needs somebody who's going to walk him through it. He's going to hold his hand and make sure he gets from panel A to B to C alive, you know, with a minimum of confusion, with as few of those moments where the reader has to sort of, whoa, what's just happened? And every time the reader goes, whoa, what's just happened? You know, we're not doing our job. We screwed up. So, you know, that's where the penciler comes in. The penciler's got to advocate for the reader.